Hello my dear viewers, welcome to the video. In this video I am going to talk about the poem Christabel by the celebrated poet Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Coleridge belonged to the romantic age of writing and Christabel is one of the finest poems that he produced. So let's get started. So first let's talk about some general aspects of the poem. And this poem is a long Gothic ballad. Now, what do we mean by a ballad? If you wish to know that, kindly refer to my earlier video where I have discussed this poetic form in detail. Now, this poem, it was planned to have 5 parts, but it is unfinished as of now. I mean, Coleridge originally wanted to write this poem in 5 parts and he completed 2 parts. But he could never complete the poem and he could never write those 3 parts which he intended to write earlier, originally. And the first part of the poem was written in 1797 and Coleridge wanted this poem to be a part of the lyrical ballads, the book that he produced in collaboration with William Wordsworth. So he wanted this poem to be a part of that collection, but Wordsworth declined this proposal, and then the second part of the poem was produced in 1800 and it was first published in 1816. So we can imagine that this poem, it kept lying unpublished for 16 years, the first part for 19 years and the second part for 16 years. Talking about the summary of the poem. Since it is a ballad, so it has a story, it is a narrative poem. And before we discuss other aspects of the poem, it is appropriate that we first know the story or the summary of the poem. So the poem, as the title suggests, it is about a girl called Christabel. So Christabel is the eponymous character here. And she goes into the jungle to pray at midnight. One fine day, she decides that she wants to pray for her fiancé, and she goes into the jungle at midnight to pray for his welfare. And there she is startled by the moaning sounds of someone. I mean, she is kneeling under an old oak tree and she is praying, but she is startled by some sounds. She listens to some sounds and she's scared. At the same time, she's astonished as to who else could be there in the jungle at that hour of the night. So she goes around that tree and she finds that there is a woman who is crying there, and the name of the woman is Geraldine. Now Geraldine, she seems to be, by her appearance, she seems to be belonging to a very good family. She's wearing white silken clothes and gems are entangled in her hair, and she's extremely beautiful. Her skin is even fairer than the silk that she's wearing. So the first impression that Christabel has of Geraldine is that she's a lady, maybe she belongs to a good family and she is in distress. So she decides to help Geraldine. Now Geraldine tells Christabel that she was kidnapped by some horsemen. 5 horsemen, they kidnapped her the previous morning and they tied her on the back of a horse, and they kept on riding for the whole day, and then they left her there in this jungle and they threatened her that if she tried to escape, they will find her and they are going to come back. So they went for some errand and they told Geraldine that they will come back and they will take her. So Christabel is extremely emotional. She is moved by Geraldine's story and she invites her to come to her castle for the night. She says that my father, she's not keeping well, but you can spend the night with me and I will not wake up any of the housemaids. I will not wake up any of the servants because it is the dead hour of night, so I don't want to disturb anyone. And you move along with me to my castle, and in the morning my father will take care of your journey. He will send you back home. So Christabel asks Geraldine to share her bed as she does not want to disturb anyone in the castle. Now this is an important point to be remembered, because Christabel could have asked one or two of her servants to prepare a new room, prepare some bed for Geraldine, but she does not do that and she invites Geraldine into her own chamber to spend the night. And while Christabel is in that room alone with Geraldine, then she realizes that Geraldine is actually not a damsel in distress. She turns out to be an evil spirit and she casts a spell on Christabel. She undresses herself and she asks Christabel to undress herself, and then she embraces Christabel so that that magic spell, it passes on from Geraldine to Christabel, and Christabel is under the spell of that magic spell that Geraldine has cast on her, and Christabel cannot speak because of the effect of that magic spell. So Christabel's ability to speak is compromised because of the spell. This is the story that is told in the first part of the poem. This video is about the first part only, so I'll discuss this much story only. So here, when Christabel is under the magic spell, at this point, this first part ends. Talking about the setting of the poem, as we have seen in the summary, Christabel goes into the jungle and then she takes Geraldine along with her and she comes back to her castle. So the castle of Sir Leolin. Sir Leolin is the name of Christabel's father. So the setting of the poem is the castle of Sir Leolin. A lot of action of the poem, of the story, takes place in the castle and the wooded area adjacent to the castle. So the jungle that is adjacent to the castle, these two are the areas where the whole action of the story takes place. And they are completely, these two areas are completely opposite in nature. Castle is, it is huge, strong, comfortable, luxurious, well organized, and you know, it is a place of authority. And wooded area is exactly opposite. It is disorganized, it is confusing, and it does not feel safe. So these two locations, which have a completely opposite feeling to them, they are the setting of the poem. Most important aspect of any creative piece of writing, the themes of the poem. So the first theme that is very evident when we read this poem is the theme of good versus evil. This poem is about this age-old struggle between good and evil, and Christabel here represents all that is good, that is virtuous, and Geraldine represents everything that is evil, and the tussle between the two, the struggle between the two is portrayed here, though we do not know the ultimate result of the poem because the poem is incomplete, but still that struggle is evident and this comes up as an important theme. The next theme which seems important is the theme of religion. Christabel is a God-fearing, God-believing girl. She is virtuous and she believes in God, and the whole poem is replete with references to Virgin Mary and Jesus Christ and the guardian spirit of Christabel's mother. So religion is an important aspect of the poem that comes up. And the third theme which is important is the theme of the supernatural. And as we all know that Coleridge is a poet who excelled in this kind of poetry. He talked about supernatural and he explored this theme in other poems also. So here also we have Geraldine, and the way she has been presented in part one of the poem, there is nothing, for most part of the poem, there is nothing which is abnormal about her, which does not seem to be human. But still, there are hints throughout the poem which suggest that she is an evil spirit, she is something extra human, and that becomes evident towards the end of part one. So the theory of poetry that Coleridge believed in, and that willing suspension of disbelief that he talked about, it has been maintained in this poem also. So apparently the poem is about an evil spirit and how that evil spirit tries to control a good spirit, but it has not been done in a crude way. It has not been done in a very crude manner, in a very unsophisticated manner. So Coleridge tries to bring about that willing suspension of disbelief while he is trying to explore, he is trying to incorporate this theme of the supernatural in this poem. Now the next theme which becomes evident is the theme of seduction. So there is seduction of Christabel by Geraldine, and Geraldine tries to allure her, Geraldine tries to seduce her physically as well as spiritually, but she succeeds in doing so physically, whereas she fails in doing so spiritually. And the next theme which is very important is the theme of memory and the past. The whole poem is replete with references to the past. Christabel's mother died when she was giving birth to Christabel, and she Christabel is never able, she is not allowed to ever forget this fact that her mother died when she was when Christabel was born. And Sir Leoline, his inability to come to terms with the fact that his wife has died, and the long time that he mourns the death of his wife, they all play an important role in the way their relationships develop. So memory and past, and how that past and the memory of the past, they shape relationships, and they they shape personalities, is an important theme to be discovered in this poem. Now, talking about the form and meter of the poem, this poem has been written in a very unique kind of meter, and Coleridge claimed that he has invented or he has made up this meter, though this claim was dismissed by later critics. But still, in Coleridge's own times, he did claim that he has made up this meter. And the meter is that he uses accentual verse rather than accentual syllabic verse. Now, what does that mean? That means that accents are count instead of syllables. While we are looking at the meter of a poem, we usually count the number of syllables in that line, in each line of the poem, to determine what kind of meter is used. But in the meter that Coleridge used in this poem, he said that you need to count the accents, that is word stresses, rather than the number of syllables to decide the meter. So he said, Coleridge said, that there are four accents in each line. So the number of syllables would not matter in a line. So irrespective of the syllable count, because the syllable count in this poem, it varies from 7 to 11 or 12 syllables. So the syllable count varies, but all the lines have four stresses or accents in them. So this is how Coleridge wrote this poem, and this is an example. This is the opening line of part one, and it says, "It is the middle of the night by the castle clock." So both the lines, they have different number of syllables, but they have four accents, that is four, only four syllables are stressed in these lines. So in the first line, midnight, cast and clock, these four syllables are stressed. And in the second line, which says, "And the owls have awakened the crowing cock," so owls, wake, crow and cock, these four syllables are stressed. So we have four stresses in each line. So instead of counting the number of syllables, and instead of maintaining a uniformity in the number of syllables, Coleridge maintained the uniformity of the accents in each line. And this poem, it does not have a set number of lines or regulated stanzas. That is, each stanza has its own pattern, has its own length. It does not have a regular number of lines. And the poem is rhymed. That the original poem is primarily composed in rhyming couplets. So either we have AA, BB, CC, rhyming couplets, but occasionally it uses alternating rhyme. Alternating rhyme would mean that alternating lines are rhyming. So AB, AB, CD, CD, EF, EF, and so on. So most part of the poem is written in rhyming couplets, but at many occasions the writer uses alternating rhyme. Now, talking about the symbols of the poem, the first symbol, which is very obvious and very important, is the symbol of light and dark. Throughout the poem, there is this combination of light and dark. When the poem opens, all the events that take place, they take place on a dark night. So the night is moonlit, but still that moon is covered with a thin layer of clouds. So it is not completely light, and it is dark. And darkness is a time which is associated with dark powers, with evil powers. And it is easy for all those evil forces to have their way. So Geraldine is able to overtake the spirit of Christabel. She is able to do all the harm that she wants to do to Christabel at the time of night. But when light comes, when the day comes, then things begin to change. They take a different course. So light and dark, as symbols of evil and goodness, they are very much there in the poem. And the next symbol, which is again important and obvious, is the symbol of bells. Now, bells, right since ancient times, bells have been a means of communication. So when there would be evening, there would be evening bells. When there will be weddings, there would be wedding bells. When someone would die, there would be funeral bells. So they communicate to community all the good and bad news. And these bells, they are there throughout the poem, whether it is the bells of the castle clock or whether it is Christabel's mother's promise that she would listen to the wedding bells of Christabel's wedding. So bells are there, they are present there, and they emerge as a means of communication. And the third and the most important symbol is the symbol of snake and dove. And this symbol is not there in the first part of the poem. It is there in the second part of the poem. And obviously, it is so obvious. And it is believed that even the writer wanted it to be very obvious that snake is the symbol of evil spirits. So snake symbolizes Geraldine. And dove, which is helpless, which is virtuous, it symbolizes Christabel. So these three symbols are important. This is all for the video. If you have any questions, any queries, you can write to me in the comment box. Thank you.